In the previous video clip, we mentioned the Everglades food web. Food chains and food webs are simply models that show how energy flows through an ecosystem. Notably, this is different than how matter, such as water, carbon, and nitrogen, cycles within an ecosystem. Since energy flows through ecosystems, ecosystems must have a consistent energy source. For most ecosystems, that energy source is the sun, which then can be used by the first level of the food chain, photosynthetic plants and algae, the producers. Before we dive into the Everglades food web, let's cover some basic physics related to energy. First, of course, we always seem to start with definitions. Energy is the ability to do work. Some common units that we use to measure energy include joules, kilojoules, calories, kilocalories, watt-hours, kilowatt-hours, etc. If you've taken a physics class, you likely know that there are 7 different forms of energy. Kinetic energy is the energy of movement. Mathematically, it can be expressed as 1/2 mv squared, where m is mass and v is velocity. Potential energy, the energy of position, which mathematically can be expressed as mgh, m being mass, g the acceleration due to gravity, and h the height. Radiant energy, which is the energy in the form of electromagnetic waves. Chemical energy, energy stored in chemical bonds. Thermal energy, heat, energy that flows from objects with higher temperatures to objects with lower temperatures. Electrical energy, the energy of moving electrons. And nuclear energy, the energy found within the atomic nuclei. So all types of energy can be classified as one of these 7 forms. Thermodynamics is the science that studies energy and energy transformations. And 2 of the laws of thermodynamics will be important as we study energy flow through ecosystems. First, the first law of thermodynamics. Energy is neither created nor destroyed, but it can change form. This is important. Energy can change from one form to another. For example, plants change their radiant energy from the sun into chemical energy that they store within their body. We can change the chemical energy that we get when we eat that plant into kinetic energy as we move around, or heat. Further, a car changes chemical energy within gas into kinetic energy. A toaster changes electrical energy into thermal energy and some radiant energy. And a light bulb changes electrical energy into radiant energy and some thermal energy. So energy can change form. Now, interestingly, when energy does change form, some useful energy is dissipated as heat, thermal energy. And this is the second law of thermodynamics. As energy is transformed from one form to another, some useful energy is dissipated as heat and released to the cooler surroundings. So no energy transformation is ever 100% efficient. There's always some energy that is dissipated as heat and unusable. A result of this is that organisms always need a constant input of energy. And another result is that food chains are limited in length because as energy is changing form from one step of the food chain to another, some of this energy is lost. So let's look at a food chain. Energy flows through ecosystems through food chains. Each step along a food chain is called a trophic level. And the first trophic level is called the producers. These are organisms who get their energy directly from the sun through the process of photosynthesis. As you can see from the general equation for photosynthesis, shown at the bottom of this slide, plants use carbon dioxide, water, and sunlight to create sugar and waste products, water and oxygen. The sugar is essentially stored energy that the plants can use later, or animals can eat. The second trophic level is called the primary consumers. These are the organisms that get their energy from eating plants. Sometimes we call them herbivores. Thus, the solar energy that the plants stored as sugar is now used by animals. Notably, when animals or plants use that stored energy, the process is called respiration, which you can see is simply the reverse of photosynthesis, and thus it yields energy. Animals, like us, need sugar, oxygen, and water to provide us with energy, and water and CO2 are waste products. The third trophic level is the secondary consumers. Predictably, these organisms eat the primary consumers. The fourth trophic level is the tertiary consumers, who eat the secondary consumers, and it continues in this manner. The secondary consumers and beyond are all carnivores. Check out this simple grassland ecosystem food chain, paying attention to the terms used. Also note that the sun is included as the initial source of energy. The diagram also shows another important player in any food chain, the decomposers. These organisms, for example bacteria and fungi, break down organic matter to its simplest constituents, such that plants can once again take the matter, the nutrients, back up with water through their roots, and the matter can continue to cycle within the ecosystem. Another interesting and very important concept that we can glean from the diagram is that as energy is transferred from one trophic level to another, some useful energy is dissipated as heat energy. This essentially follows the laws of thermodynamics. We remember that the second law of thermodynamics says that as energy is transformed from one form to another, some useful energy is dissipated as heat. Thus, there's less and less energy available for each trophic level along the food chain. In fact, a general estimate is that only about 10% of the energy is transformed up from one trophic level to the next. Wow, that's not much. Some of this energy is dissipated as heat as it's transformed, or some of it's converted to other forms of energy, for example, kinetic energy. But importantly, there's another reason for the low rate of energy transfer as well. The entire embodied energy of one trophic level is not consumed by the next trophic level. For example, bones and hair are rarely completely consumed by the next trophic level. Further, feces still have a significant amount of stored chemical energy, and the next trophic level is not eating this either. That's not to say that this energy goes to waste. Some of it's used by decomposers. But it does help explain why such a small percent of the energy of each trophic level is transferred along the food chain. And it helps explain why food chains are generally quite short. They would need an enormous base to make a long food chain. Food webs are simply slightly more complex models that show all the different feeding relationships that exist within the community. It is rare that an organism only has one food source, as a food chain suggests. Thus, a food web is a more robust picture of who eats whom and how the energy moves through the community. Of course, you can dissect a food web and come up with several different food chains within that food web, if you so desire. Here's the Everglades food web that we've already looked at several times. Again, it's simply a more robust model of the energy transfer through an ecosystem. However, you can dissect it and find specific food chains as well. Yet another model for showing the energy transfer through a community is called an ecological pyramid. The ecological pyramid, sometimes called the food pyramid, gives us a visual representation of the energy loss at each trophic level. The first trophic level, the producers, has to be very large in order to support a long food chain. Again, remember the second law of thermodynamics, and remember that the entire trophic level is not eaten by the next trophic level. Indeed, the energy pyramid helps us visualize why food chains generally are not longer than 5 or 6 trophic levels. There simply isn't enough energy. In order to have a food chain of 6 trophic levels or more, there would have to be a very large base of producers. Finally, here's an ecological pyramid of the Everglades. Notice the large base, and then it gets narrower as it goes up, because at each step along the way, only about 10% of the energy from one trophic level is being transferred up to the next trophic level. On this particular ecological pyramid, they've placed many different species from each trophic level on the pyramid, so you can get a feeling for the food web as well. Here you can compare the food web and the ecological pyramid models simultaneously and see how they're similar, see their strengths and their weaknesses. Notably, several questions on this week's assignment pertain to the concepts of food chains and food webs. In particular, you'll be watching a video on Mono Lake and answering questions about the Mono Lake food web.